Hour on Radio City Talk.
Radio City Talk.
My name's Mick Coyle and welcome to Dad's Hour for another week. It's that time of the week we sit down and we talk about parenting matters with two dads. Joining me in the studio, Ian Christie's here.
Afternoon, Mick.
And you live next door to Che Burnley, but he isn't here yet.
I know. I could have offered him a lift. I didn't. And he's not here. But in fairness, in true dad style, I think as long as you've left the house at the time that you're meant to be somewhere, then really you're on time. Because time is in fact flexible. It's a loop. Stephen Hawking proved that.
No.
So it's like, circular.
If you're a podcast listener, that's the case because you can stop and start. But this is also a live radio show and timing is not flexible on that.
On the podcast, we could maybe introduce Che. You could cut in the best of Che. Producer John, could you cut in the best of Che from the last few shows? I mean, won't take you a little while to find some best of Che, but we'll get there. I've noticed as well, Mick, that you've very professionally switched on Che's mic as well, as if he were here.
Oh, yeah. I didn't even realise I'd done that.
So, well, I could, if you want, I could sort of shuttle between the two mics.
By talking oddly in an old
accent. Oh, copper calling. So, yeah, if you're listening out there, Che, send us a tweet. Let us know you're okay. You okay, hon?
No, apparently he's okay and he's on his way.
Oh, good.
You know we do these studies from universities and we go, well, no one's paying attention to that.
Yes.
That's a silly study. What about this one? The Guardian. Weekend lie-ins, not enough to recover from sleep loss, study finds. Research suggests link between disrupted sleep cycles and unbalanced metabolism. Having a good lie-in at the weekend might not make up for sleep loss during the working week. But it's got to help, has it? No. Apparently not.
No, I think that this is the last thing they can take away from us. I think this is when they finally turn around, the man, the powers that be, and say, we've whittled you down to nothing except that one beautiful moment on a Sunday every 4 weeks where your missus gets up and goes, I get up with the kids, you have a bit of kip. Like, now that, not good for you now anymore.
Also, like, for me, a lie-in pre-kids was like 11:30.
Oh, but yeah.
Like, a lie-in now is, if I got to 9:15 and I was still in bed, I would get like ticker tape cannons. I would set off fireworks.
Living the dream.
I would dance.
Living the dream
for the entirety of the day.
We actually went out on it was oh 2 weeks ago, no 3 weeks ago on the Friday. And I wasn't out. I was out. I think I'd ditched the car, but I was like 2 pints out, maybe three pints out. You know, and so I got in. I got back by about 11:30. Midnight, and for some reason, like my wife had to get up early on the Saturday morning anyway, so she got up and she got up with the kids, and I had the strangest feeling ever when I opened my eyes at about it must have been eight o'clock by the time I opened my eyes. I looked at the clock and I thought, hang on, the wife's downstairs, she probably thinks I've got a hangover, but I haven't got a hangover, but so I can have hangover leeway. You know when you've got a hangover and all you want to do is stay in bed you can...
I forgot what that feels like, but yeah, I know what
you mean. You can rather selfishly just go, oh, look, just leave me to die for another hour at least. But I got that. So I stayed in bed till like 9:30, but I wasn't hungover. So it was like... It was like a real... Do you ever remember lions pre-kids? You know when you just stay in bed because you wanted to stay in bed, not because you physically couldn't move out of bed or because, you know, you were chained to the bed or you were sick. You remember those lions? It was one of them. It's like an hour and a half.
Special time. Oh. Researchers say the signs are that basically if you have a lie-in at the weekend after a busy week, any benefits are transient. But to be honest, as a parent, I will take transient.
Yeah, I'll take a transient benefit.
If someone says to me, Mick, there's a benefit here, but it won't last forever, I will go, give me that benefit. That's like, in many ways, like the more transient, the better. Just that brief feeling of, yep.
Yeah,
that's fine.
It's all good.
Particularly on a Saturday, like, because if someone said to me, the benefits of having that lie-in by, say, at 8 o'clock on a Saturday morning have worn off by 11, I would bite your hand off for that.
But that's essentially parenthood. You're getting from one transient benefit to another. There is nothing that can fix what's happening.
But the thing is as well, I know I'm going to feel how I'm going to feel at 11 o'clock on a Saturday morning anyway. Yeah. So I may as well enjoy a transient benefit in between 7 a.m. and 11 a.m.
Exactly. And if nothing else, the phrase transient benefit is likely to enrage UKIP supporters. So I just like the phrase transient benefit.
By the middle of another working week, the body's metabolism is just as disrupted, if not more so, if they had not slept in. So basically, if you just carry on. I think most people do that actually as a parent naturally. You have that thing where your sleep cycle is set. That on a Saturday morning, it's actually quite hard, even if you get the chance to lie.
Oh, you can't.
Your body's going, no. You're up by now. Kenneth Wright, the prof, he did the
survey. Prof Kenneth Wright.
It's as bad, if not worse, in some cases. While he said it is not clear if the practice could offer benefits, if only used occasionally or with little sleep loss, the message is one of caution. This yo-yo of going back and forth between burning the candle at both ends and catching up and burning the candle and catching up over the long term is probably going to do some harm. Writing in the journal Current Biology, Wright and colleagues described how they studied 36 participants who spent 13 nights in the lab, the first 3 nights getting about 8 hours sleep. While 8 people were allowed to continue with this pattern for the rest of the study, 2 groups of 14 went on to have their sleep deprived, getting just under 5 hours a night. At that point, you go, is this what I signed up for?
Fine, isn't it? 5 hours a night.
However, while one group was allowed to indulge in lie-ins and set their own bedtimes after 4 nights, those in the other group were not. After the weekend, both groups had a further 2 nights of sleep deprivation before being allowed to recover. The results revealed those who were allowed to lie in did, with men sleeping more than women and participants not rising until about noon on the Saturday. But the team said that even in that case, the total number of hours slept did not make up for the number of hours lost earlier in the week. And that's the other thing around this. Nobody, right, is thinking they're ever getting the time back. Like, there is not a single parent out there who is thinking, you know what, all those hours that I've lost because of getting up, they're a write-off. That they are bad debt. They are toxic assets. You're never going to see that time. And no parent secretly thinks, I'll tell you what, soon, once they've stopped throwing up in the night, when they've stopped being sick, when they start sleeping, I'm going to be able to sleep 13, 14 hours. No parent is expecting that. What they want is the ability to cope. Give me that amount of sleep.
Realistically, I think you can get it back. Because if you tot up the hours that you've missed, you know, when they're babies and that, you know, you're up, and especially you've got one of them, you've got two of them, you've got three of them even, you're constantly disrupted sleep. Oh, I managed to get 4 hours in a row last night. Brilliant. Well done. Followed by another 2 hours of staring at the ceiling just before I got woken up the fifth time. Now, if you tot up all of that, there is a way to get it back. I mean, you're not going to like this, but you're going to have to go into a coma for 4 months. So I think when kids, maybe you should do it as a benefit at work, where basically when your kids leave home, your last one goes or turns 18, then you can legitimately go into work and say, like paternity leave, and just say, now I need to take my empty nest leave. I'm going to take 3 months off. And then you go up to the Royal and they put you in a medically induced coma. And you restore over the course of those 3 months, and then you'll be fine. You'll be fine.
It's that thing, isn't it, where it's, you know, when you put in your holiday application, it goes reasons for holiday application. You could just put going into stasis.
That'd be amazing. That would be brilliant.
You get in there, the door would close. And suddenly you'd just pause, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Doing like in the exact pose.
You'd have to do it like Han Solo in the Carbonite with your arms up like that. That's the way I'd do it, definitely.
But then what I'd like is, but then the problem is you're in stasis and you're on pause, you'd then wake up, you wouldn't have felt the benefit of having the sleep. That's the thing. You'll wake up and go, oh, you do that thing, like, oh, I've slept too long.
Someone said that in work the other day. I nearly stabbed him.
No, you go, I've not had any coffee and I've got a terrible headache.
But then you'd have a couple of glasses of water and you go, oh, hang on. Oh, yeah, my legs work again. Like the muscle, my leg muscles don't ache. Do you ever have that day when you want to wake up one day and your muscles won't ache? It'll be exactly like that, Mick. That's what's going to happen. And also, you might have missed 3 months of your life, but the kids will be 18. They don't change much at 18. They'll still be as grumpy then as they were before. Like, you'll switch EastEnders on. Exactly the same stuff will be happening. Brexit will still be going on. Everything will still be exactly as it was. Because if you took 3 months out of your life, you probably wouldn't miss much. Not at our age.
The other thing is, like, at what point, though, would you go, this is the point at which I need to take the rest? Because I think it feels like sometimes parenting is just constantly doing irreparable damage to your body. Like your hair's going grayer or it's falling out. And it's like a you can't be thinking, when I get to 18, I'm going into stasis. Because by that point, everything's already kicked in. All the damage has been done. The bones are creaking. The hair's white.
I'll be honest, there was a definite cut-off point when my youngest turned 2.5, where I started to sort of get a grip again. Because bear in mind, my eldest is 2 years, just over 2 years older than her. So essentially 5 solid years of dealing with kids under the age of 2.5, nappy changes, waking up in the night, bottles, all of that. Even when they're toddlers, stop throwing stuff around the place, stop smashing it up, constantly on edge, you know, constantly like, oh, don't play with that. Don't run into the road. Don't. And I remember the, looking in the mirror and looking at this sort of pudgy sack of pasty nonsense. And then thinking, oh, I used to be a human being. And that was when I started like going, oh, right, what do I want to do? What can I reintroduce? And so we got the dad's game of football going. I stopped eating pizza for every meal. And slowly but surely, I became the magnificent specimen that you see before you now.
He bought a sports car, convertible, started wearing leather jackets, started dyeing his hair.
The trousers, the full
hit. Chatting up girls in their 20s. He got it all back, and he's never looked back since. Ian Christie's with us for Dad's Hour on Radio City Talk. Coming up, there is a charity which is setting up a new service which will include text messages sent to families with tips on being a successful parent. Now, if we were in charge of this tech service, what sort of text would be arriving? We'll talk about that and more, and hopefully we'll see Jay Burnley next.
This is Dad's Hour. My name is Mick Coyle. We've got Ian Christie with us in the studio.
Hello, Mick.
So Jay Burnley also with us this week. One of the production team, Hannah, she was at one of Jay's pub quizzes the other night.
Yeah.
Jay said, I'll see you Friday.
Yeah.
She said, see you then. Hi, Jay. You okay, pal?
Yeah, I'm all right.
What part of Liverpool are you in at the moment, mate?
Near the Manchester Apollo, that part of Liverpool.
Just yeah, round the corner.
Just going round your corner now, mate. Jay, remember...
I'll be with you in a couple of minutes. Just hold on.
Jay, remember when we booked you in for Dad's Hour?
Yeah.
Do you know, fair enough, it is a bit of a surprise because it's not like... I mean, it's not like he's done the show before. He doesn't know it's always on every Friday at about 1:30. It's not, you know, it's a new thing for him.
You know what? Yeah, there is no excuse. But here's my excuse, right? I woke up late this morning, and I'm always
it's not a blues song, Jay.
I've always wanted to play the Apollo, right? And also, one of my jobs is putting posters up outside the Apollo. So I thought, you know, start from the ground up, and that's where I am now. I'm in a car park of the Apollo, regretting my decisions.
you woke up and you had a dream, thinking if I go and put some posters up outside the Apollo, they'll see me and they'll go, now there's a guy with red hot poster action. That's the guy that we need on stage. Or do you put the posters up in an amusing way?
That's what I'm doing. I'm doing like little air kicks, you know, whoa, and doing the Markham and Wise dance.
Flagging down box office staff and telling them one-liners.
you know me too well. Here's another one. You can use this one. So I'm currently in Manchester. Do you want me to see if I can make it back?
You've got 11 minutes. As long as they build High Speed 3, like now.
Within the next 3 minutes.
And you're on it about 10 minutes ago. I think there's every chance you'll be here for the close of the show.
All right, cool. Has Ian been holding up his end of the bargain with lots of dad puns? Has he been all right without me?
Don't try and undermine Ian's work here, because he's failed to deliver a single pun so far today, but I don't want to criticise him.
Hang on a minute. I don't need to take this kind of stuff here.
Chase...
I'm far enough away that you can't hit me.
Stay safe out there in the wild west of Manchester, and we'll see you again very soon.
Okay, see you soon.
Never again.
There you go, that's Jay Burnley. I'm not even allowing him to plug his gigs. Oh, by the way, last week Chris Cairns was on the show. Chris Cairns, by the way, supported Bill Burr, the comedian, on stage at the film.
Superb.
So if anyone knows their stand-up comedy, we know that Bill Burr's probably top three hottest properties on the planet, and Cairns was doing the stand-up. If he came on, he'd make light of it or he'd try and do a joke about it, but genuinely a brilliant thing. And everyone's seen Chris do his act and his warm-up stuff. It was just a brilliant opportunity.
It really was, and getting Bill Burr into the city, I think, was amazing, and that was all down to Paula and Chris at Laughter House getting him over here, because I think he was over doing a tour anyway, but they got in touch directly with him and said, oh, look, do you want to do Liverpool? And so that Liverpool date happened because of them. And I believe they sent a selection of acts by video to him saying, who do you want to support? And he arbitrarily picked Chris.
Yeah. Although to be fair, the other options were me, you, Jay.
Yeah, a waste paper bin. but no, apparently it went down a storm. He was saying what a great gig it was. Everyone's been saying what a great gig it was. So yeah, well done, Kenzie. I actually hope he's not listening. I don't want him to hear this praise.
It's one of them, isn't it? It's one of them. So last week on the programme, we were talking about damage. There was this bill, the average bill for a parent, damage caused by kids was £400. And I put that up on the social media. I got so many brilliant responses to this one. I'll probably not be able to get through them all, but I'll just mention a few of these. James says, because I said about the thing about one of my dad's mates had reversed his car through the gate and the door got stuck in the gate. James says, bumping a car without parents knowing is not something at Kebabster 75 or I would know anything about, Your Honour. Jay Daly, he says, Mick, our lad managed to put a Lego brick through the middle of his nan's brand new UHD Samsung TV. A Lego brick through the middle of it. I mean, I can't even work out.
I mean, Lego's tough.
But the forces involved in that, that is a running leap, isn't it? That's got to be a running leap.
When we were kids, my best mate, we were only about 6 or 7, and he managed to completely rewire our video, our VHS, because he was really into his technology, even as a 7-year-old. And also, when at home, he managed to rewire their burglar alarm somehow. So when his dad came home, the burglar alarm went off and nobody could switch it off.
That's a proper childhood action there. And dads need to know how to rewire their own burglar
alarm. Exactly.
That's absolutely something they need to be on board with. James says, Mick, my mate leaned on a cabinet containing 16 years and thousands of pounds worth of Ladro from Spain.
Ladro pottery.
Fell over and smashed every last piece.
Oh, brutal.
Still moans about it to this day. I don't know if his mate still moans or if his parents are still moaning. various other people got involved in this one. Will did the same thing to his mum's car in 1976.
Never forgiven. 43 years on, still gets brought up.
Sam Avery, currently on tour. He says, Mick, my kids have created an unholy stench that has seeped into the brickwork. The value of our house has plummeted. He said, Jim says, as a kid, Mick, playing living room football and catching a sweet volley that smashed my mate's mum's £200 ornament.
Oh, brutal.
Steve says, Mick, usually throwing iPads and Kindles on the hard floor, smash, no pocket money for the rest of your life. Kate said, my 4-year-old decided to show off his parkour skills on the washing machine door, which promptly snapped off 5 days before Christmas.
Ah, it's timing as well. They do it with time. It's always going to happen on a bank holiday or as you approach the festive season, you know, or just when you need something, that's when the kids will smash it.
Kate, by the way, who got involved in that conversation, she's a regular contributor to the station and she's also a mum. And there's quite a lot of mums. Now, mums, they are in many ways rivals, but in many ways they are
our oppos, our counterparts.
Yeah, but for next week, when it's International Women's Day, we're going to class them as what they truthfully are, our co-conspirators in parenting.
That sounds like a plan.
Because we would not be dads if it was not for the mums. Yep. So what we're going to do is, alongside yourself, I'm running this by you live on air,
okay,
so you can't criticize the idea, is we're going to host, essentially, an open day.
Okay.
For mums.
So hang on.
Whereby dads...
In Dad's Hour.
Yeah, yeah.
But that sounds like our thing.
Yeah, I know. But what we're going to do is we're going to make it about us.
Okay.
And we are going to use it as an opportunity for dads to ask, not our own partners, but other people's partners.
Yeah.
Questions to which we need to know the answer to. So imagine like the agony aunt situation, but these are going to be agony mums. For instance, like if you want to know why your partner doesn't wear that underwear you bought her 3 years ago, or... Yeah. When she said she lost the earrings that you bought her, but you did still see the box in the bottom of her cupboard, what's going on there? So if you've got questions for our agony mums next week's show, it's about them.
Pregnancy cravings, are they made up? Because I'm pretty sure they're made up. I'm almost certain they're made up.
And what we're also going to do is we're going to get some of the dads who regularly contribute to ask questions.
Yes. People going to tweet in their questions?
You can get involved. Questions. So if you've got questions, particularly questions which you'd love to ask your own partner.
Yeah.
but you are afraid to, or you think it's not the right thing. Now, if you're thinking, oh, you know, it's going to be misogynistic, it's absolutely not. We're just going to block you if no. it is. No. So if they're not going to be sexist, it's not going to be misogynistic, it's not going to be like, hey, love.
Genuine questions.
Are you going to make us a cup of tea?
Genuine questions. And if you are tweeting in and you do want to send it, but you don't want us to say your name or your Twitter handle on air, just, you know, hashtag don't tell the wife. And then so that way we'll preserve your anonymity.
Let's go with that.
And then we'll go for it, yeah.
So if you want to drop me an email, you can do mick@radiocity.co.uk and I'll put your questions to the mums next week. That's mick@radiocity.co.uk. Maybe you've got like a birthday coming up. You want ideas. Maybe you've bought terrible gifts in the past.
Yeah, when you say you don't want anything for your birthday, you don't really mean that, right? That kind of...
Yeah, when you say you're fine, what do you really mean?
Yeah, what does fine mean? I mean, wow. So we've only got an hour, yeah?
Yeah, I was going to say that. I mean, that we're going to have to start off with the fine. That's going to be the most important thing. And the mums are absolutely on board with this.
Excellent.
As well. If your questions are a bit, then we're not going to use them because it's about them being co-conspirators equals...
Just think.
In parenting.
How much information we could unearth in that little dad's hour section next week. We could change parenting and relationships forever.
I think potentially we are going to do that. I say potentially.
This guy, I mean, Mick, can you smell another award?
Kate and Becky Davis is going to be involved in that one too. So do get involved. Mick@radiocity.co.uk or hashtag don't tell the wife. No, we're not using that. Hashtag Dad's Hour if you've got questions, and we'll give them a mention, or you can just tweet us directly. Families with young children will be sent parenting tips by text as part of a series of government-funded projects being rolled out by two education charities across the north of England. This is the Education Endowment Foundation, based in Leeds, and they've been recruited by the Department of Education to run a number of parenting projects across 375 schools and nurseries. This includes a tips by text service for parents of 4 and 5-year-olds involving 2,700 families across the north of northeast. We probably won't get it here. The aim is to encourage activities that help develop literacy, numeracy, as well as social and emotional skills, such as counting the number of plates on a table. This seems like a good idea. Part of me would think that, though, if you just received a text which might go, get your kids to count the number of sheep that they see on the way to the countryside, you might go, yeah, fine, I might do that. But if you had an alternative system, which was bored 8-year-old, send.
Oh, that'd be good.
And then you get like a reply direct going
that says only boring people get bored.
that comes back with actual proactive things to do. You go for that, right?
Definitely. I think it needs to be a flood of phrases that you can use to sort these things out with your kids. You know, take that out of your nose, stop it in your sister. You know, that sort of stuff.
I like that. Like you get like almost like love hearts.
Yeah.
But like, she'd be like, things are going to get better.
That would be brilliant.
You'll sleep when you're dead.
It's going to be okay. There's no such thing as normal. You know, that sort of stuff. Because that is the question that we asked most when they were little. You know, you kind of go, is that normal? Right. Because when you read about parenting, like they tell you, oh, this happens and that happens and that happens. And your kid does something and you go, is that normal? Because that wasn't in any of the books. And then you ask your mates and you realise that, no, you're not alone. And also, there is no such thing as normal.
Yeah.
Their kid won't have done exactly the same thing, but they will also have had to ask that question.
The one I go for is, it's just a phase, which is basically, I have no idea why she's doing that. And neither do you. And it's absolutely doing me head in. I'm just hoping that it stops at some point.
If we ignore it, it'll go away.
That's exactly what... Oh, it's just a phase. That's exactly what that is.
Yeah.
So that is the charities Shine, the Education Endowment Foundation. If you receive one of these messages, do send it on and let us know. It includes videos showing positive parenting techniques.
Positive parenting techniques by video. They're not candid videos then, are they? They'll be, you know, if they were sort of like secret videos of actual parenting, I think I'd probably take more out of that. So you can say, look at them messing it up as well. Whereas if they do proper parenting videos, they'll be like those 80s public information films, you know, about not trapping your tie in a shredder and things like that.
I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, but Mick, what do Esquire magazine think of parenting?
Do you know,
up until this point, I've never thought that ever.
Just about to ask you that.
They've got a dad to write down the ranking of all the guilts of modern parenting. So it's the things that you have to think about and then whether or not you're actually doing the right thing.
Oh, no.
So, for instance, new clothes.
Is that for you or the kids?
Mary Cray, head of the government's Environmental Audit Commission, has stated that going after fast fashion, cheap clothing, won a handful of times before being discarded to landfill, is an important issue. But you're a parent. Everything you buy, your child is inherently disposable because they'll outgrow it in a matter of months. However, you can put aside your guilt by buying clothes from a sustainable, eco-friendly brand.
Like Primark.
Or, if you're not literally the richest person who ever lived, hand-me-downs also work. He's given that a shame rating of 8 out of 10. Screen time?
Oh, that that does make me feel guilty. Not guilty enough to really stamp down on it. But, you know, because, like, screen time, it's one of those guilty things where you say to the kids, right, after an hour, you come off that, and it gets to 55 minutes, and you go, oh, they are quiet, aren't they?
Yeah.
And the second half's just starting. So maybe if we went an hour and a half... stretch it to an hour 40, and then you start the argument as to when enough is enough.
Working?
What, sending them up chimneys and that?
As far as I'm able to tell, writes this correspondent, 90% of the internet is either made up of articles about parents who feel guilty for working or articles telling parents that they should feel guilty for working. but he has a shame rating of that, 1 out of 10. And having kids in the first place... about the fact that basically, if you want to do something to save the environment, don't have kids. Although he says that actually, 0 out of 10.
I literally never thought of that one.
If anyone makes you feel guilty about your decision to have children, poke them in the eye, throw them down the stairs, set them on fire, and tell them the only people who shouldn't have children are their parents. There you go. Strong words. Heritage there, right? In Esquire magazine. We get opinions from Esquire magazine more often, maybe.
Well, I think there's no shame in having kids because it's one more extra person to recycle, isn't it? You know, start doing all that. It's good.
What, when you need a kidney?
No. Well, all yes, right. But no.
In many ways, that's the ultimate in recycling, isn't it?
Santa Howard does not endorse stealing your own children's kidneys.
Ian, thank you for your time. What's going on at the Royal Court?
Just finishing up Yellow Brick Road. We've got Brick Up 2 starting next week, which is an absolute belting show, so get your tickets in for that one.
If you want to know what Jay Burnley's up to, just literally go to the Manchester Apollo. He's putting posters up for whatever it is.
In an amusing manner.
Dad's Hour, back next week. Available as a podcast as well. You can also download every single previous edition of Dad's Hour for absolutely free via your podcast provider. And don't forget, next week, it's International Women's Day, so we've got mums on the show. Agony mums who are going to solve all our problems. All of them.
All of them.